If you follow Formula One racing in the slightest, you've probably heard of the debacle between Haas F1 and Rich Energy Drink. Oh, I'm sorry, now known as Lightning Volt Limited, which may or may not be a money laundering scheme that may or may not actually sell energy drinks. It is a hilariously unfortunate series of events that features former CEO of Rich or Lightning Volt Limited, discount ZZ Top Guy, and some unknown bombastic person in charge of their Twitter throwing shade at Haas F1 in every way imaginable. It's hard to follow, confusing, but most importantly, hilarious. But before my fellow NASCAR fans start laughing too hard at the misfortune of this F1 team, I feel like I need to remind you of NASCAR's own past with sketchy sponsors, team owners, and track promoters. Here's a short rundown of just a few of the worst liars, thieves, and lawyers to ever disgrace NASCAR with their presence. In the early days of NASCAR, you didn't have to worry about big companies trying to screw you over by getting free advertising, because sponsoring a race car was just kind of unheard of at the time. You might get some random mechanic shop on the hood, or if you were really lucky, some oil manufacturer would wave a few thousand at you to put their decal on your fender. The biggest thing NASCAR drivers had to worry about was track promoters just taking off with all the money after the green flag flew. It would really suck to spend all that money and time trying to get to the track, paying the entry fee, winning the race with your now banged up car, only to find out that there isn't a trophy and your check is probably going to bounce on Monday. It was fairly common practice in the wild early days of stock car racing, but once NASCAR took off in the 1950s, they did their level best to distance themselves from any tracks that didn't pay up. Even still, a few miscreants slipped through. Bowman Gray Stadium was paved in the late 1940s by the city of Winston-Salem, on the agreement that the promoter would share a portion of ticket sales revenue with the city. He held a few races, but when it came time to pay up, he skipped town with all the cash, and no one ever heard from him again. While track promoters and owners would avoid tangling with big NASCAR for the big shows, on the weekly racing scene, they were a lot more unscrupulous. There's absolutely no shortage of stories of tracks just shortchanging drivers, and in general being cheapskates and jerks. So let's just focus on one for now. The Blackwell brothers, Tom and Pete, operated my hometown track of Greenville Pickens Speedway from 1955 until 2003. My grandfather and uncle who raced there would often complain that if it even remotely looked like it might rain and scare off fans, they'd cancel the night's races in a heartbeat. And a former boss of mine who grew up in the same neighborhood as the Blackwell brothers told me that they were the biggest hucksters he had ever met. And that former boss of mine now works in management for a Fortune 100 company, so that's saying something. All manner of drivers from the lowest division to the highest have an endless plethora of tales of the brothers' conniving ways. But one story that always stuck out to me was of a contractor they had brought in during the 50s to build a privacy fence around the track property. Now, I can't confirm this story to be true. The Blackwell brothers have since passed away, but I've heard this story so many different times from so many different people over the years, and it changes so little from person to person that it must have at least some kernel of truth to it. So anyway, here we go. Legend has it that the Blackwell brothers hired a contractor to build this fence around the track to keep freeloaders from watching the races for free. Fair enough. But they told the contractor they'd pay him when the job was done. The contractor finished the job, but when it came time to collect, the brothers always had some sort of excuse. Oh, we're out of town right now. We sent it to you in the mail. You didn't get it. Oh, our office is closed at the moment. Try again later, etc., etc. Well, on one day, the contractor decided he had had enough and took matters into his own hands. He knew where the Blackwell brothers counted the money after the races, so one day after the events, he kicked in the door with two guns and said, "I got two pistols, one for each Blackwell brother, and y'all are gonna pay me what I'm owed, or you two are gonna figure out whether or not these guns are loaded." They let him sift through the money, he took exactly what he was owed, not a penny more, and left. They considered calling the cops, but if the contractor knew where the count room was, then he probably knew where the Blackwell brothers lived, and they figured he could find them before the cops could find him. They decided to let bygones be bygones and just let it slide. Hell, he didn't even charge him interest. I call that a win. Track owners and promoters have a long, tumultuous past in NASCAR, but perhaps the more well-known and better-documented ne'er-do-wells are some of the car owners. Now, I'm not just talking about the cheaters like Junior Johnson and Smokey Unick. I'm talking about the guys who cheated, were a pain to work with, torpedoed their own organizations, and maybe even committed a bit of fraud to make it all happen. BK Racing, contrary to their name and paint jobs, actually had no affiliation with Burger King. Team owner Ron Devine was only a Burger King franchise owner, who had finagled the licensing rights to run Burger King logos when no other sponsor could be found, which was basically every single race. That's right, Burger King got free advertising from the team. As far as I can tell, they never actually paid the team a dime. Dr. Pepper, which is served at Burger King, also had a similar agreement. As it turns out, the team had used their questionable sponsors, quote-unquote, to lure in more loans than they could pay back. and before the green flag flew for the Daytona 500 in 2018, they had essentially said that they would be shutting down by the end of the year, as they battled a litany of court cases. Somehow, they still managed to make every single race, and even though Front Row Motorsports bought the team in the later half of the season, the team still ran under the BK Racing banner all the way up until the bitter end. Michael Waltrip Racing had a turbulent lifespan, to say the least. They started off by having all three of their cars make the starting grid for the Daytona 500, but then old Mikey's car, the Napa 55, got held up in tech inspection. Officials had found an unknown substance caked on the bottom of the intake manifold. After some testing, a few reports erroneously declared it to be jet fuel, but actually it was a lot closer to rocket fuel. It was an oxidizing agent designed to feed more oxygen into the engine for more horsepower. For his trouble, Michael Waltrip got fined at that time a record-setting $100,000 and was docked 100 points before the season had even started. And crew chief David Hyder and NWR director of competition Bobby Kennedy were physically ejected from the speedway and suspended indefinitely. Yikes. Michael Waltrip would fail to qualify for the majority of races that year, and his team was abysmal. Domino's jumped ship from the 00 team at season's end, and UPS did the same from the 44. Mikey could always pull some big money together, but a race team? It seemed like it would never happen. But then in 2011 and 2012, they started riffing off wins, and even finished second in the point standings with Clint Bowyer. And then, Spingate. Whose idea this was and who actually orchestrated this is a bit murky. But we do know that general manager Ty Norris and Brian Patty, crew chief for Clint Bowyer, both gave their drivers clear and distinct messages to alter the end of the race. Bowyer spun himself out on purpose, and Brian Vickers pitted on the restart to give their third driver, Martin Truex, a better shot at making the chase. All three drivers were docked 50 points, Ty Norris was suspended indefinitely, and all three crew chiefs were put on probation until the end of the year. And Michael Waltrip Racing got bopped for another record-setting $300,000 fine. They even lost a few sponsorship deals because of the affair, and that caused them to lose Martin Truex as a driver, and the whole team closed its doors at the end of the 2015 season. However, Clint Bowyer still had 1 year left on his contract through 2016. And the way his contract was written, wherever the team and his sponsor, 5-Hour Energy, went, he went too, as part of a package deal. Well, when MWR went belly up, H. Scott Motorsports bought up the team, and Clint had to sacrifice a year of his career driving for a backmarker team that had no idea what it was doing. He could have bought himself out of the contract, but there weren't any rides open at the time. So he stuck it out and took over Tony Stewart's old ride at season's end. Remember, kids, always leave yourself an out in your multi-year contracts, or you might just end up driving for Rick Ware Racing. Yuck. Nobody wants that. Driving for an unscrupulous owner can suck, so you might consider being an owner-driver. Going that route's a lot tougher, but doable. But what if you didn't have the money to do that, didn't have any sponsors willing to back you, and you had no experience even being in a race car? Well, that would put a halt in any normal person's pursuit of speed, but L.W. Wright was no normal guy. Who was L.W. Wright, you might ask? Well, myself, NASCAR, Sterling Marlin, and a few investors would really like to know that too. Black Flags Matter did a whole video on this guy, so I'm going to put a link to that video down below. But here's the gist of it. L.W. Wright convinced the head of Space Age Marketing in Nashville that he was a veteran NASCAR driver looking to start up a big league team, with the help of country music star T.G. Shepard supplying the sponsorship. His first race was going to be the 1982 Winston 500 at Talladega Superspeedway. The first problem was when Nashville newspapers got wind of this, they reached out to Shepard to ask him what his expectations for the team were, and apparently this was the first time Shepard had ever heard of the whole deal. L.W. Wright saved face by saying that announcing the T.G. Shepard sponsorship had been a bit premature, and that it was still in the works. Wright had secured enough money from Space Age to buy a Chevy Monte Carlo from Sterling Marlin for $20,000. Damn, race cars were cheap back then. And he paid $17,000 up front in cash and wrote a check for the remaining $3,000. Sterling took the deal, but as the week's activities dragged on, he quickly realized that L.W. Wright was not who he said he was. Despite claiming to be a veteran NASCAR driver, he had no documentation to back that up, which wasn't unheard of at the time, but no one could recall ever racing against him in the past either, not in any division. He struggled all week in practice, had a minor wreck in qualifying, and kept asking basic questions that anybody who had raced for as long as he claimed he did should know. Race day came, and his engine blew after just 13 laps, and before the race had even finished, he had skipped town, left his car and all of his equipment at the track, and all of his checks to Sterling, NASCAR, and his business partners bounced. Arrest warrants were issued, and the head of Space Age Marketing hired a private investigative team to find Wright and bring him to justice, vowing, "We'll get him sooner or later, he'll end up in jail before we're through." The only problem was, that never happened. To this day, nobody ever found L.W. Wright or even knows who he was or why he did what he did. Some random schmuck straight up defrauded his way into a NASCAR Cup ride. What a freaking legend. Car owners can be a bitch to work with, but sponsors are even worse. If they decide not to pay up or back out, it can basically blow up an entire team and end a few careers. Such is the case of Kevin Conway, Front Row Motorsports, and Extends. Extends was Kevin's primary sponsor pretty much through his entire career, and they were a company that sold male enhancement pills. I'll let you use your imagination to determine what male enhancement means. Conway was a terrible driver, finished poorly in nearly every single one of his starts, but won Rookie of the Year honors pretty much by default as he had no competition. He got let go by Front Row in the back half of the 2010 season, and after that he kept driving for Robbie Gordon and Joe Nemechek. But then Robbie Gordon and Joe Nemechek found out the hard way why Front Row had booted Conway in the first place. Turns out all those Extend sponsorship checks ended up bouncing, and the two teams were owed millions of dollars. Extends never paid up because they were busy fighting court cases and dealing with the fact that their pills didn't actually make your pee-pee bigger. Turns out you can't just say that your product does one thing and then it never does that thing. Who knew? Everybody sued everybody and nobody won. Robbie Gordon and Nemco pulled out of NASCAR shortly thereafter. You might think that sponsors killing teams and pulling out of contracts is a relatively new phenomenon, since back in the day they used to just pay up with one big lump sum at the beginning of the year, and nowadays they pay on a month-by-month or even a race-by-race basis. But in 1998, Tabasco proved that even the lump sum approach is rife with problems. You may recall Todd Bodine sporting these awesome paint jobs promoting Tabasco hot sauce to kick off the 1998 season, and people at the time touting that this would be Todd Bodine's breakout year. But oh man, those people were wrong. International Sports Management, or ISM, had teamed up with Bodine and Tabasco to create the 35 team, and they were horribly underprepared. They failed to qualify for four of the first six races, but did manage a front row start and a top 10 finish in Atlanta. Tabasco, however, didn't seem to mind. Instead, they had went all in on using the team as an elaborate marketing scheme. They promoted the hell out of the car, Todd Bodine, and their partnership with Pontiac. Hell, they even had a cookbook made. By mid-June, the car had only qualified for 5 of the first 13 races, and ISM wanted a change. They were here to race, not to sell hot sauce. They booted Bodine without Tabasco's consent, and began hiring a variety of different drivers with mixed results. ISM eventually sold the team in the back half of the season, again without their sponsor's knowledge, to Tyler Jet Motorsports, who had purchased Darrell Waltrip's 17 team. Tim Beverly, now in charge of the 35 and 17 teams, merged the two and hired Darrell Waltrip to drive what was essentially his own car, and the team started doing far better. It helped having DW's championship provisional so that they could actually get into the race. They even made the switch from Pontiac to Chevy, without telling their big sponsor again, and Tabasco was furious. Eventually, Tabasco got the team to switch back to Pontiacs, which were horrendously slow that year, and DW suffered for the remainder of the 1998 season. Tabasco was so upset with the ordeal that they backed out of the sport at season's end and never came back. They wanted their star driver results be damned. Instead, they had tapped six different guys to drive the car, and four of them had actually made starts with the team. And that is the tale of the Tabasco fiasco. Tabasco was fully prepared to dive headfirst into the marketing angle of the sport, but some sponsors are anything but prepared. Nature's Bakery signed on to sponsor Danica Patrick after their previous sponsor, GoDaddy, had left. Only problem was, Nature's Bakery didn't realize NASCAR was in a state of decline at that point, and they felt that they weren't getting the visibility that they were promised. Not to mention, Danica Patrick was also endorsing rival food products, so Nature's Bakery decided to just not pay up anymore. The problem was, they were contractually obligated to pay up for the next 2 years, and nothing in the contract said Danica couldn't endorse other products. Stuart Haas Racing, made up by that same Gene Haas dealing with the same problem over in F1 right now, sued Nature's Bakery to the tune of $30 million plus interest, and eventually won. They put the money to good use too, and straight up dominated the 2018 season, with all four of their drivers getting wins and Kevin Harvick having one of the best seasons of his career. Then there's the electronics recycling service, Zloop. They sponsored a few tracks, races, and most notably the son of the company's owner, Justin Boston. In the early 2010s, Zloop kinda came out of nowhere, and were flinging million-dollar checks left and right, but they always cleared the bank, so nobody bothered to ask the Bostons how their little recycling service was making so much money. As it turned out, it wasn't. Robert Boston, the company's owner, had defrauded investors of nearly $25 million just so he could fund his son's racing career, spending upwards of $5 million a year just to get him rides with Kyle Busch Motorsports, Joe Gibbs Racing, and Venturini Motorsports, in everything from ARCA to trucks to Xfinity races. In court proceedings, it was revealed that Zloop was spending more in marketing alone than they had brought in total revenue. I'm no business expert, but that does not sound sustainable to me. Robert Boston faced criminal charges, was convicted in 2018, and was sentenced to 10 years in prison. But still, the question remains, was he the worst dad ever or the best dad ever? I mean, he did get his son some quality rides. But the absolute king of shady modern-day sponsors has to be DC Solar. Not only did they roll up onto the scene out of nowhere, start spending millions in the sport, and sponsored entire race teams and tracks, but when the chickens finally came home to roost, they ended up sidelining a driver's entire career, defrauded Warren Buffett of hundreds of millions of dollars, and ran a fraud scheme that was fueled by new investors and federal tax loopholes. DC Solar manufactured, sold, and leased solar-powered electric generators and began sponsoring Chip Ganassi Racing and a few other teams in 2016. And by 2018, they were pretty much the exclusive sponsor of their Xfinity program. Ross Chastain had won for the team in a storybook scenario that put the humble watermelon farmer straight to the top of nearly every NASCAR fan's favorite list. Things looked good, and there were really no signs of any trouble until one night just before Christmas in 2018, the FBI raided the home of Jeff Karpoff, the owner of DC Solar, and the company filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy shortly thereafter. So what the hell happened? Well, of the 12,000 solar generators they had made, only about 3,000 to 5,000 of them were real. The other 7,000 or so supposedly had GPS locators on them, but then it turned out that those locators were just buried in random locations across California, making it appear as though they had been purchased and set up. Warren Buffett had poured over $300 million into the company, but had made decent returns, but only because DC Solar was funneling money from new investors to Buffett. There's a word for that. It's called a Ponzi scheme. You're not making any money, you're just shuffling it around to make it look like you're making money. At the time of the raid, they owed Chip Ganassi Racing nearly $4.5 million, and still needed to pay up millions of dollars to ISC on tracks. With no sponsorship dollars rolling in, CGR nixed their Xfinity program and cut Ross Chastain, who proceeded to take any ride he could get and has since bounced back. Criminal investigations are ongoing in this case, but it's safe to say those pretty DC Solar paint schemes are never coming back. So there it is, a relatively short rundown of some of the worst fraudulent businessmen, hucksters, and schemers to ever show up in NASCAR. They've been here a while and they'll keep popping up, and with teams so strapped for cash these days, we can pretty much guarantee that NASCAR will be a good breeding ground for these types for decades to come. Anyway, I'm Slapshoes and I'm sorry you had to watch this. Take it easy. I'll lie again and again, and I'll keep lying. I promise.